Dear students, welcome back with lecture number 4. I hope you all are fit and fine and enjoying your quarantine days and not disturbing your moms. So today we are going to discuss grammar, which is included in your unit number 1. The contents which I'm going to discuss are parts of speech and types of sentences. This is Sumaira Zaheer, your English teacher from Army Burnhull College for Girls. The very first question that comes into your mind must be, what is grammar? Actually, what is grammar? So what we can answer is, English grammar is the way in which meanings are encoded into wordings in the English language. This includes the structure of words, phrases, clauses, and sentences, right up to the structure of whole texts, nouns from the largest word class and verbs the second largest. If we talk about parts of speech, though, the very first question that comes into mind is actually, what is part of speech? We can categorize English words into 9 basic types called parts of speech or word classes. It's quite important to recognize parts of speech. This helps you to analyze sentences and understand them. It also helps you to construct good sentences. Now there is a table of parts of speech. This is a summary of 9 parts of speech. The very first is verb. Since your childhood, you have been taught by your teacher what is a verb. We always say verb, it shows action or state of being. Like when you are doing something, so that means verb is performing something. To be, have, do, like, work, sing, can, must, these are all verbs, examples of verbs. English Club is a website, or I like English Club. Like is a verb, is a verb. Noun. Now, simply, what is a noun? Actually, we know it's the name of a person, place, or a thing. Or we can also say everything created by God in this universe, it bears a name, and that name is a noun. So things or it can be used for things or persons or places. For example, pen, dog, work, music, town, London, teacher, John. This is my dog. Dog is a noun. He lives in my house. House is a noun. House, since it's the name of a place where you live. We live in London. London is a noun. Adjective. It describes a noun, or it adds to the meaning of a noun. Or we can also say that it tells in detail about a noun. What does the noun do? Is the noun good, big, or what is the color of the noun? Similarly, well, interesting, it is interesting or not. My dogs are big. Now, dog is a noun and it is modified by adjective, that is big. I like big dogs. Then determiners, they limit or determine a noun. A, an, the is the definite article. To, some, many, these are all determiners. For example, I have 2 dogs and some rabbits. Then preposition. What is the role of a preposition in a sentence? It links a noun to another word in a sentence. For example, to, at, after, on, but. Then adverb. Adverb adds to the meaning of a verb. It tells us clearly what the verb is doing. It describes a verb or an adjective or sometimes another adverb as well. For example, quickly, silently, well, badly, very, really. My dog eats quickly when he is very hungry. He eats really quickly. Conjunction. What is the role of conjunction? Conjunction is used to join clauses or sentences or words. Like two sentences or two clauses are joined together with the help of conjunctions. Examples of conjunctions are and, but, when. For example, I like dogs and I like cats. I like cats and dogs. I like dogs, but I don't like cats. Interjection. This is most famous amongst you students. The moment you see your result or any such thing, so you cannot control your emotions and you just shout. This is an example of interjection. Short exclamation of your feelings, sometimes inserted into a sentence, like if you are feeling good or bad or lonely or sorrowful or happy, you always show your feelings. So these are interjections. Oh, ouch, hi, well. Ouch, that hurts. Hi, how are you? Well, I don't know. Some grammar sources traditionally categorize English into 8 parts of speech. Others say that there are 10 parts of speech. At English Club, we use the more recent categorization of 9 parts of speech. Examples of other categorizations are verbs may be treated as 2 different parts of speech. Some are called lexical verbs like work, like, run. And some are called auxiliary verbs like be, have, and must. Determiners may be treated as adjectives instead of being a separate part of speech. I have revised this parts of speech just for your sake. You have been doing it since your childhood, lekin actually it was included in your unit number 1, so that's why I have tried to revise it quickly. Adjectives, adverbs, conjunctions, interjections, nouns, prepositions, pronouns, and verbs. Now I hope you know their functions, what functions they perform. So now we will discuss what is a sentence or what is the definition of a sentence. A sentence is the basic unit of language which expresses a complete thought. Like when we talk to each other, so obviously we use a sentence. And what is a sentence? It's a combination of many words, but these words are written in a proper order so that it should give us a proper meaning. It does this by following the grammatical basic rules of syntax. For example, Angela is the cutest girl in the class. A complete sentence has at least a subject and a main verb to state or to declare a complete thought. Like it must be giving us a complete meaning. A complete thought means a complete meaning. So you can divide sentence into these two basic parts. First one is subject, the other one is predicate. Now what is the subject and what is the predicate? In simple terms, a sentence is a set of words that contain a subject. Subject is what the sentence is about. This is the subject. Or the topic of the sentence is the subject. Or what is the sentence about is the subject. And what is predicate? Predicate is what is said about the subject. Like what is being told about this subject in this part of the sentence, that is called predicate. And now there are types of sentences as well. So the very first type of sentence is simple sentence. A simple sentence is a main clause which has no subordinate clauses. Like it has its own one verb and one subject, and functions as a sentence in its own right. A simple sentence is only simple in terms of how it is made up of clauses. It is not always very short or very simple in other ways. The sentences below are all classed as simple sentences. They vary in length and in how many phrases they contain. However, each contains only one verb phrase which is highlighted, like they have only one verb. Everybody hesitated. The firm has launched a full investigation. This evening, French police were out in force at key points around the city. You can read the rest. As a simple sentence contains only one verb phrase, this means it expresses just one situation, or one event, or one state. This is often useful and we can add some detail in other phrases as we include. However, sometimes we need to express more than one situation in a single sentence and relate these situations to each other using compound sentence and complex sentences. Let's see how. We have simple sentences because they contain a subject and a predicate and they express a complete thought. For example, the boys went to the park. And there is a tip. A simple sentence is also called an independent clause because it is all the meaning. If the meaning is clear to you, so that means it is an independent clause because it does not need any other part to complete its meaning. There are basically three sentence types: simple sentence, compound sentence, complex sentence. Now, what is compound sentence? It contains two or more independent clauses. Clauses are joined by coordinating conjunctions. For example, the boys went to the park, but they did not go to the zoo. Now here, they are connected with the help of a comma. Complex sentences contain an independent clause and a dependent clause as well. The dependent clause begins with a subordinating conjunction. In detail, we will discuss it in the next slide. First of all, compound sentences. You may recall that a compound sentence is a sentence with two or more main clauses, usually joined by a coordinating conjunction. What is a coordinating conjunction? And, but, or, for, or, nor. Let's have a look at some examples and think about how this type of sentence can be useful. If you look at this example, there are thousands here today and the atmosphere is electric and is coordinating conjunction. And if you compare it with this sentence, there are thousands here today, so it means this is a separate sentence. The atmosphere is electric, this is another separate sentence. So we have joined together these two sentences by adding and here. By linking the clauses with and, the speaker indicates some kind of link between them. The conjunction and does not tell us specifically what kind of link, but we can work out that these are two related facts. The thousands of people probably helped to create the electric atmosphere. Actual example, there's another example. Jethro's a good lad, but he's keeping bad company. Same. Jethro's a good lad, separate sentence or separate clause. He's keeping bad company, another separate sentence or separate clause. But we have connected it with the help of, joined it with the help of coordinating conjunction, but. The conjunction but here relates two comments about Jethro and contrasts them. On the one hand, his character is described as good. On the other hand, the company he keeps is said to be bad. Other examples, a compound sentence has at least two independent clauses that have related ideas. The independent clauses can be joined by a coordinating conjunction. Coordinating conjunction for and, nor, but, or, yet, so. Or they are also joined by a semicolon, as you can see in the compound sentence examples below. In either case, each half of the sentence must be able to stand on its own. Like it must be having a clause which is complete in its meaning as a complete sentence. That means each half needs a subject and a verb. For example, I want the sporty red car, but will lease the practical blue one. We can leave this example. we can discuss fanboys. What are fanboys? F stands for for, A stands for and, B stands for but, and N stands for nor, B stands for but, O stands for or, Y stands for yet, S stands for so. So these are fanboys, are also called coordinating conjunctions, or coordinating conjunctions are also called fanboys. Compound sentences with coordinating conjunctions. As you have seen above, many compound sentences are made using coordinating conjunctions. In this case, the sentence must contain a comma before the conjunction for correct punctuation. For example, she did not cheat on the test, comma, for it was the wrong thing to do. I really need to go to work, but I am too sick to drive. You can read the rest. Compound sentences can be joined together with the help of a semicolon. It's also possible to join compound sentences simply by combining two complete sentences into one long sentence without any additional words. In this case, you must use a semicolon to join your two independent clauses. For example, Joe made the sugar cookies, semicolon. Suzanne decorated them. While this is grammatically correct, it's also possible to smooth the transition from one clause to the other with conjunctive adverbs, such as however. These are called conjunctive adverbs. However, besides, therefore, and meanwhile. However, besides, therefore, and meanwhile, these are also called conjunctive adverbs. To use these properly, place them after the semicolon and add a comma after the conjunctive adverb. For example, it was a difficult assignment, semicolon. However, conjunctive adverb, comma, Kelly was up to the challenge. Observe additional compound sentence examples joined by semicolons below. The sky is clear, semicolon. The stars are twinkling. The waves were crashing on the shore, semicolon. It was a lovely sight. The rest you can read. Now, what is a complex sentence? A complex sentence is a sentence that contains one independent and at least one dependent clause, sometimes called a subordinate clause. Like the dependent clause is also called the subordinate clause in a complex sentence. An independent clause is a phrase that would make sense if it were a sentence on its own, whereas a dependent clause will not form a sentence on its own. When these two types of clauses appear in a sentence, we create a complex sentence. For example, I like to eat the candy before I watch a movie. Now, what is before here? I like to eat the candy is one independent clause, as it would make a complete sentence on its own. It's complete. Its meaning is complete. Before I watch a movie is a dependent clause because it is starting with before, as it does not make a complete sentence on its own. It is starting with a subordinate clause. It is dependent on the first clause for the phrase to make sense. Like, before I watch the movie, what? What would you do? What would I do before I watch the movie? The sentence is incomplete. So we need to add it to this part of the sentence. Before I watch a movie, I like to eat the candy. Or before I like to eat the candy before I watch a movie, to give complete meaning. Examples of complex sentences. In the examples of complex sentences below, the dependent clause comes first. Notice that the dependent clause begins with a subordinating conjunction. For example, words like since, because, while, these are all subordinating conjunctions, and that the clauses are separated by a comma as well. Because, subordinating conjunction. He was late again. One clause separated by a comma. He would be docked a day's pay. While I am a passionate basketball fan, comma, I prefer football. In the complex sentence examples shown below, the independent clause comes first. Notice that in most examples, there is no separation of the clauses by a comma, which is the general rule in complex sentences starting with an independent clause. Like if they are starting with an independent clause, then you do not need to use a comma. However, the last example has a comma as it is an example of an extreme contrast. This extreme contrast refers to the clauses expressing ideas that are almost opposite in meaning or that must be heavily emphasized. For example, having a party is a bad idea because the neighbors will complain. There is no comma in it. I'm extremely happy since I retired. The since is subordinating conjunction. The dog jumped on his lap while he was eating, while subordinating conjunction. Annie was still crying. There is this comma. Although she had been happy about the news. Independent and dependent clauses, like what are independent and what are dependent clauses. We have mentioned several times that a complex sentence contains an independent clause and at least one dependent clause. This is the formula as well. One independent clause and one dependent clause. But what are clauses in a sentence and why are they important in grammar? Let's look back at the earlier example of a complex sentence. I like to eat candy before I watch a movie. As we started earlier, I like to eat candy is an independent clause. It makes sense as a stand-alone sentence. Before I watch a movie does not make sense on its own. However, let's check the sentence again. I like to eat candy, but I don't like to eat popcorn. The sentence now contains two independent clauses, like I like to eat candy, this is the independent clause, and I don't like to eat popcorn, another independent clause, could both form complete sentences. The example has now become a compound sentence, one that contains two independent clauses joined by a coordinating conjunction but, so then it becomes a compound sentence. However, there is an important distinction to be made when a subordinating conjunction is added to a clause. These words such as since, whenever, although, because, they act to make a clause a dependent clause, even if it looks like an independent clause. Like if the clause is starting with these conjunctions, so it will become a dependent clause. I like to eat candy is an independent clause because it makes its sense clear or its meaning is clear. Because I like to eat candy is a dependent clause does not make sense on its own. Because I like to eat candy, it becomes a dependent clause because it is not giving us the meaning properly. It does not make sense. So, on its own without more information. Common complex sentence examples. This is the formula as well. You can check it out. Like dependent clause plus independent clause, comma splits the clause. Independent clause plus dependent clause, comma usually does not split the clause. So using that structure, we can easily form examples of complex sentences. Despite her advancing years, comma, Elisa was still the best player on the team. Or, Elisa was still the best player on the team despite her advancing years. There is no comma in it. Since Hannah got here, comma, she has been nothing but trouble. Hannah has been nothing but trouble since she got here. I hope you have understood it. Complex sentence. A complex sentence is a sentence that contains one independent and at least one dependent clause. While I am a passionate basketball fan, I prefer football. A compound complex sentence. A compound complex sentence is one with at least two independent clauses and at least one dependent clause. For example, Jim does not drink beer because he has a gluten allergy, comma, so he tends to drink wine most weekends. So he tends to drink wine most weekends is the complex side. Subordinating conjunctions. There are dozens of subordinating conjunctions in English language, and their usage is intrinsically linked to dependent or subordinate clauses. Common examples of subordinating conjunctions include after, before, even, though, although, as much as, when, whenever, because, as long as, while, since. These words and phrases act as modifiers to a sentence, sometimes changing the phrase from an independent clause to a dependent clause. There are two main ways to think about subordinating clauses. A word or phrase that introduces a dependent clause. A word or phrase that links an independent and dependent clause. Using subordinate clauses in complex sentences. As we mentioned earlier, a subordinate clause is another way of terming a dependent clause, both words subordinate and dependent, offer clues to help us better understand the function of these clauses in writing. Dependent means contingent, or on, or determined by, whereas subordinate means lower in rank or position. That tells us that grammatically speaking, subordinate or dependent clauses are not equal to the independent clause in a sentence. The independent clause and subordinate clause are not equal because the latter cannot form a sentence, the subordinate clause. The subordinate clause is as such dependent on the independent clause to provide the complete meaning. You cannot create a complex sentence without using a subordinate clause. Other types of sentences, for example, compound sentences, simple sentences, can exist without subordinate clauses. When you think about it, the subordinate clause is what makes the sentence complex. The subordinate clause requires the help of the independent clause for it to make sense. It reaches back or forward across the sentence to contextualize itself, making the sentence more complex in the process. So, on a lighter note, it is said that grammar makes you grammarian. So, beta, no mistake. You cannot commit a mistake, as no mistake allowed. Why? Look at this simple example. Let's eat, kids. You have not seen a comma here. Let's eat, a comma. It becomes let's eat dinner together, kids. So stay healthy, stay happy. Goodbye. Till the next lecture. Allah Hafiz. God bless you all.